You don't know the preaching, the message I'm bringing, but your song. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. I will explain. Because where is the sinking sand that you're going to see? He's not talking about the terra firma, the physical land. No, he's not talking about it. Where is it? We drive and walk on solid ground, right? Yeah. It means it goes beyond the ordinary English word we are saying. Okay. He said that one person built, he heard the word. And he was relating the building to the word. Listen. He related the building to the word. And your approach to the word. He said you'll be like a man who built his house. He built the house. Not that he didn't build, he built. But the foundation was sand. But the one who hears the word, first you must hear the word. It means you need teaching. And is able to obey, he will be like a man who built his house upon what? A rock. Jesus says, upon this rock. So you have heard another word, rock. Same word, rock. It is very important. And I'm saying Jesus was linking the story to the word of God. Hallelujah. Now let me explain. What it means actually is this. You can know some truth. You can even quote scriptures. If your knowledge of Jesus Christ, and don't forget, I said that the people, they even said that you are a prophet. That is correct, because Jesus is a prophet. But if your knowledge of Jesus is only that he is a prophet, you have a piece of truth. Hey, what's a sand? Those who have done geography. Sand is just particles of a rock. Sand is particles of a rock. It means that you don't have consolidated truth. You only have a particle of truth. And if you build your life on particles of truth, you will not be a solid Christian. So when the wind blows, because Jesus said, that man who built the house upon the sand, when the wind blew, oh, great was that fall. That is why so many Christians have fallen, because they know a little bit of truth about Jesus. You can even be caught in scripture. We need a consolidated knowledge of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. And that is the rock. You become unmovable, unshakable, because your foundation is strong. That is why what Chairman has brought to me is very critical. The dual purpose of the church. That you come to church, we have to equip you with truth. We have to give you knowledge. In fact, Isaiah actually said that, Isaiah 18 verse 6 said that wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of your times. It shall be the strength of your salvation. Now that you have been saved, you need wisdom and knowledge. Knowledge. But revelation is simply a knowing. You know something, pretend new. But it is the source. Who taught you? It's God. So revelation is simply what? A knowing. Knowing comes from knowledge to get something. So the Bible is saying that wisdom and knowledge will be the stability of your times. And if you want to be strengthened in your salvation, you need knowledge. Isaiah 18 verse 6 is there. So will you be that man who built in the sand? You all built. In 1 Corinthians chapter, I believe 15, 45 to about 47. Talks about two men, two Adams. The first one is on the earth, sand. The second one, he sees his spiritual. The second Adam, which is what the last Adam actually, he came from above. If you build your life upon revelation, you shall be like that. You shall be spiritual. You shall be like the last Adam. But if you build your life upon particles, sand, you shall be like Adam. Great will be, and Adam fell. Great will be your fall. That's why Jesus was saying, the wind came. Was it, I will build my house upon a rock. Upon a solid rock. When the storm shall reach, I will still be confident. Why? Because my house will not fall. It is built upon the rock. That's why we sang the song. Okay, this one says, I am under the rock. Still, you are dealing with the rock. If you are hiding in the rock, nothing can move you. Nothing can move you. So let's see a few things. Then we'll move on. Ephesians 4:11-14 said that we must not be tossed about like little children. Actually, there's a guy I wanted to show you who had a little knowledge, particles. And I don't want you to be tossed about by any way of doctrine. So I want to let you see. I say that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of what. Once you hear any doctrine, you are being. It is because you are not on the rock. You are excited by any particle. No. As by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of this deceitful plotting. No. Let me show you a man who knew some particles of truth. And I see people like that. Sometimes, okay, I don't want to say something, but sometimes you can see it. You can see it. Some people go to Bible school, they think that if they speak in Greek, is Greek Bible or is language? You have to even question yourself. Jesus Christ. If I'm talking to you, I say, spoon cry in Ghana languages, which I can speak. It's called Awari. Have I impressed you? I'm only giving you the language equivalent of a certain object. Is it Bible? It's not biblical knowledge. It is language. The people who live in Jew, the Jewish land, they speak in Hebrew more than you, but they are not saved. They are not saved. The people in Greece, they speak Greek more than you, but they are not saved. It doesn't mean they understand the Bible better than you, right? Not at all, because it's a language. It's a language. So Chairman was telling me, I'm with him. So, someone explained it, I said, the Greek meaning of this is this. So what? We have the English. So what? Because, even when you go to Greece, they are using English Bibles. It's not a Greek language that makes you know that you know the Bible. Oh, forget it. It's just, I can also give you the Spanish equivalent. And maybe somebody can give you the French equivalent. Don't you? So don't be bamboozled by somebody quoting Greek or no, because that is not the Bible. It's language. But we have come for Bible. No language studies. I want to open your eyes to things. Because some people think they can impress you by, forget it. Let us explain the Bible. Let's explain the Bible. Hallelujah. I don't need Greek. I don't need revelation. Listen, who is the greatest teacher? Do you know why the Holy Ghost was given to you? I said, I am giving you the Holy Spirit. He will teach you. He will lead you to all the truths. Not some Greek professor. Tell me. And that's what Jesus is saying over here. Peter, it was my Father who revealed it to you. We need the Father to reveal things to us.
Amen.
It's like deep stuff that only the Father can tell you. Only the Father. So we must not be like children being tossed about. I want to give an example of a man who had some knowledge, but it was not consolidated. Pentecost. Acts chapter, I believe, 18, 24. Let's look at this guy. Oh, Lord, help us. Masakara Bishara Bayaba. Acts, are you there? So now I'm setting G. Look at this guy. And I like the Bible itself. When the Bible describes somebody, you can't doubt it. This is God's description of this guy, Apollos. I like Apollos, but see his wickedness. Now a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man. When the Bible says somebody is eloquent, my brother is eloquent. And mighty, even he, the acquirer, said he's mighty in what? He's mighty. He hasn't got simple but the guy has got some stuff. Mighty in the scriptures. Okay, and he came to Ephesus. Read on. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord. In fact, not only was he mighty in scripture, the Bible says he was also fervent in spirit. He spoke and taught accurately the things of the Lord. Though he knew only the baptism of John. I was not firing. Then some people heard him in the church. So he began to speak. He was speaking very boldly. When Aquila and Priscilla, they were in the church one day, and Apollos came firing left and right. When they heard him, they took him aside and said, come, at the church. Come, Apollos, you are good. But when we listen to you, your knowledge of Jesus is limited. And they explained to him the way of God more. And we were told that he was mighty in scriptures. So quoting Bible left and right, it don't mean anything. Somebody with even the Muslims, they can take your Bible and chew and pour, because they can recite Quran cover to cover. Muslim children, you how do you know that? Oh, they can take that your Bible and chew from Genesis to Revelation and pour it to you. But it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean you know Jesus. It doesn't mean you have a revelation of who even the Son is. So they explain to the guy more. And as the man was saying it, it is this, it is that, it is that. But we were told before that he was mighty in what? And I'll take your time. Listen. That's why I said I like what Chairman is doing today. We need to learn. We need to teach people. But we are saying that the church is built upon the rock. And we are saying the role of. Please go back to Matthew. Let's see when you get revelation what happens. Let me see some great things, and I'll go to the different types of revelation that will end. My purpose is to show you the different types of revelation that will end. Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Verse 18. "And I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades," I will explain the gates of Hades too, probably this time or next time. Yes, next one. Let's move. 19. Now listen. Because Peter was the one. No, Jesus was talking to 12 disciples. Don't forget. It's not like it's only Peter and Jesus who are standing there. There are other people around. But Peter is the one who opened his mouth to say, "You are Christ, the Son of God." Okay. So Peter was able to reveal the sonship of Christ. He says, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven." So who was Jesus talking to? There are about 12 people standing there. When Jesus asked the question, one answered. Now Jesus is saying, "And I will give you," who do you think Jesus was talking to? Peter. Yes. He was talking straight. In fact, even before that, this verse before, he said, "You are Peter." He mentioned his name. Because you got a revelation. Listen, revelation brings keys. That's what I'm trying to say. Revelation brings keys. Listen, church, it is not just a coincidence that on the day of Pentecost, they had all been baptized, but it was Peter who stood up because he got a key. When they were going to the temple, it was Peter and John walking, but it was Peter who said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have," he had received the key. Yeah. Yeah, coincidence. Because Jesus said, "I'm giving it to you, Peter." So Peter became the same because by that revelation, he received the key. Church, I say again, we need revelations from God. Because revelations will give us the keys. Then, this statement will be true. And whatever you bind, listen, a lot of Christians today are binding and loosing, and nothing is happening because they don't have keys. If you don't have keys, you can't go about binding and loosing. No demon will move. Because you don't have a key. But we know one demon who was able to testify before the sons of Israel, say, "Peter, I know. Paul, I know." You see, even the demons, they know those who have the keys.
Oh, church.
I want to humble myself for God to teach me. You can come to church many years and not know who you really are. I'm bringing you somewhere. He says, because of this revelation you have received, I am giving you key. Keys are for what? Closing. Let me tell you, most of the problems in church, if you get the revelation, you have the key to open and close it. I'm telling you.
Oh. Example.
People have asked me questions. I appear somewhere, and somebody was asking a question. The question, the way he asked it, it is, let me put it this way. He just wanted to say this. Who do you think you are? He put it in another form. And I could tell that he's looking at my confidence. He's looking at my ability to speak boldly. But you know why? Jesus, he didn't come into the world to be the only Son of God. Jesus didn't come into this world to be the only Son of God. I'm taking you somewhere. Jesus is the only begotten Son we know. But Bible says in John chapter 1 verse 12 that as many as believed him, he gave them the power also to become the sons of God. Therefore, what Jesus the Son of God can do, if you believe, you can do it. You can do it. But first you must get the revelation of sonship. So when you have the key, you can open, you can close. Now, Jesus said, and the gate of Hades shall not prevail. I've heard people explain the gate of Hades, the gates are a meeting place. Let me give you another revelation. Well, I want to give you another revelation. That's why I said, I don't go by what some Greek pastor said, no, or Hebrew, no. Let's just stay here. The gate. What are gates for? If you build a house and you put a gate there, why do you think you are putting the gate there? Thank you. You are preventing unwanted people, trespassers, like you shared your testimony today. Because without a gate, a trespasser can walk in. So gate is to prevent somebody out there from entering your house. Actually, it's not to keep you in the perpetual. No, it's to prevent the outsider from entering. But Jesus is actually saying, and the gate is plural. It says the gate of Hades. Do you know that when we say we are going to possess nations, there are many people in the world who are bound in the gates of hell. They are bound, but how will you enter there without a key? That is why he's giving you a key. And he says that when you stand at the gate of hell, and you decide to open, the gate of hell shall not prevail against you. Amen. You shall open it. That's why he himself said that I came to deliver those in bondage, those in captivity. Are you understanding me? Those guys are in the camp of the enemy. So he has to give you a key. And that's why Peter, on the day of Pentecost, having received the key, he preached a sermon and released 3,000 souls out of the gate of hell into the kingdom of God. There are several gates. Financial gates. So when you come to the church, I said we can end poverty in the church. If we can get a revelation concerning the financial gates, I can share with you many testimonies of how God has brought me personally and other people just using revelation.